Yeah, Dad's Hour is back for another week. We're into the summer holidays. We're nearly in the middle of August. Who am I kidding? It's only still the start of August. Jim Johnson's in the studio. Jim, great to see you.
Thanks very much, Mick. Is this like a sort of transfer dad line, sort of loan from the big panel? That's what I am.
I think that the parenting equivalent of that is August the 31st or bank holiday weekend when the kids are going back into school and you suddenly realise you don't have pumps. And you're scratching around and used to get your pumps from somewhere, but they're not available or they're too expensive.
So we've had this conversation. My wife's with me. She's just showing my little boy around the view. And we were talking about this thing kind of on the way in about school shoes. When is the optimum time to choose shoes?
Well, it's not this week, is it?
Well, only that, she said. I'm telling you, Jim, she goes, I'm not getting into that bun fight. The last weekend back, because it's literally take a ticket and wait. But of course, you have to understand that everybody wants to leave it to the last minute because they want to get the optimum amount of time out of their shoes. So I'm with you. It's like, I think it's one of those things where you've just got to wait. You've got to brass it out.
Gemma Roberts is making a debut on Dad's Hour as well. Gemma, you're a mum. Great to see you.
Hello. Yeah, I am. I don't have to worry about these things just yet, to be honest, because George is only two. So, well, he's nearly two. So I can learn from you guys about school about school and what I have to worry about. I am starting to worry about which school he goes to and stuff like that. Apparently you've got to worry about that early on now.
It's definitely a thing.
See, at the moment with the school uniform, so my eldest is she's 3 and a half, so she's going into preschool. Mm-hmm. But it's not preschool free-for-all. It's preschool that comes with like a jumper. So we've had all the forms through, you know, it's like, would you like to buy? And it's like, no, we wouldn't like to buy these. But we would like to find another parent whose kid is about to leave this and who's only worn this jumper for six months and has been laundered, and that will do. And that is the jumper. And we have found that friend, and that has saved us an absolute fortune.
Really? She's
going, well, we've got these, but then they changed the badge slightly, but you can still wear the old badge. I was like, it doesn't matter. At that age, it doesn't matter. But shoes is always a big one. And I've talked about buying shoes before in the past. My three-year-old, she's got quite flat feet as well, so you can't just buy the cheaper supermarket type shoes. You've got to buy the brand that we all know which brand we're talking about, the brand that everyone has to get good quality shoes, and it's like £35 minimum at least.
Yes,
you can't do hand-me-downs on shoes as well, because then somebody else's foot shape.
I've got to tell you though, actually, my sister-in-law, if she's listening, she won't thank me for telling you. I only discovered this the week. She's got three boys, and her middle boy is a very placid individual. You see, he's deep waters is a good way to describe him. And he's got a toe complaint, right? He's like 18 now. He's a grown man, but he's got a toe complaint. And the toe complaint stems from the time he didn't tell his mum and dad when he was about 9 that he needed his shoes changing, right? Because he didn't want to bother them, right? And apparently, it stunted the growth in
him. Oh, no.
I know, you shouldn't laugh. I mean, it's like a joke in their house. But he it's like, well, you know, the shy bairn really gets no shoes. Do you know what I mean? As they say, and he didn't crack on that he needed new shoes. Oh. And as a consequence, he's
like
paying the price.
Dickensian tale, that isn't it?
It's a terrible child.
I actually worry now, because talking about this, you're saying your daughter have flat feet. George actually walks around on his tiptoes still, and he's almost two, and everyone goes, he's on his tiptoes. And everyone's got me really worried, and I'm going, I think it's okay, isn't it?
Get him high heels.
Yeah. We were in said shoe shop, and all the other kids are getting their shoes tried on, and obviously my kid is running around in circles around the shop on his tiptoes.
I'll tell you something else on the subject of PE kits. So in primary school, obviously, for beginning of the year, you get the obligatory shorts, white T-shirt, and the plimsolls, the pumps. And of course, the one thing, this is one thing that is commonly overlooked by all parents, is when they come home at the end of the year, you have completely overlooked the fact that you haven't changed those pumps all year. What size are you? I'm size 2 and a half, Dad. But they say 13. You know, and you think to yourself, How are you even wearing them?
No, but that's why they've got that stretchy bit on them. That's what it is. What are that? The plimsolls, pumps. I can almost still like smell that sort of dusty, rubbery thing. Like, very strange, very strange. So, guys, on the show today, I've got a list of the top 10 things only a parent can know. Now, there'll be plenty of people out there who have similar experiences, who have, I'm sure, cats and dogs, you know, or elderly relatives living with them. But I've got a top 10 list here. I'm going to go 10 through 1. There'll be some which will flag up with you, others which may be totally irrelevant. Number 10 to me, because I've got a newborn, is really relevant. You'll eat most meals with one hand.
That's a thing. Yes, that's definitely a thing. Yeah.
So I went out for a meal which ended up being a burger, and I had one of my mates was sat next to me. And I went, do us a favour, mate. I said, will you cut that in half for me? And he looked at me like, what's going on? But I thought, I can't pick it up in one go because I had the baby in the other. I can't pick it up in one go or it's going to be too big and it's going to go everywhere. I thought, well, if he just cuts it in half, I'll be able to pick that up. If a bit falls out, at least it's only going
to
be half.
You know, there's almost like a sub point to that, to number 10, because actually your dining out decisions are based primarily on the dexterity with which you can eat the meal, you know. So in addition to the fact that, Mick, you've got to get your mate to cut your, you know, there are only certain places where that is even applicable. I mean, you can't do that with a baguette.
No, well, this is true.
You know,
see, the other thing for me in that is there somewhere where you can leave a pram? Because I very much like the abandon the pram as close to the door as you can, but it's always in the way, Gemma. It is always in the way. Yeah. It doesn't mention here as well the number of meals that you eat or food that you eat while stood over the bin. Do you ever do that thing with when you have like food that's left and you think, I'm not just going to throw that? So just then you just eat the food before you throw it in the bin. Do you know? Is that no? Is that just me?
Maybe.
Me and my wife are two ends of the spectrum in terms of our eating habits, right? I eat really quickly, freakishly quickly, right?
My husband does.
Right, and my wife is the slowest eater in the world. It's like painful, right? And she, you know, she organises her food, puts the condiments out. Everything's a work of art, you know what I mean? She's got exacting standards about everything. But it really played to our benefit when we had the babies, because I would just like get on with it, bang, and then I'd take over babying while she did the ritual of what she needed to do. So I think point 10 was not applicable to the Johnson family.
Well, number 9, I don't think, Gemma, number 9 is actually true at all. It's kind of a romantic view, but I don't think it's true. You'll never tire of staring at your baby.
Oh, I'm going to be controversial with some mums here who will probably go, oh, you don't tire, but of course you do. Everyone does. As beautiful as your little cherub is, there are times when you want to just go, can I just be me again for 5 minutes? You know,
but
I think
also,
everyone does.
You'll never tire of it. Fine. Stare at your baby for 3 minutes. Stare at your baby for 5 minutes. But I tell you what, after 7 minutes, you're going to be thinking, you don't actually do anything, do you? Now, my new one, he's brilliant. He's brilliant value. He'll smile at you. He'll laugh. He's almost developed this thing where, you know, he kind of sees you coming into a room. He'll follow you around. Brilliant. He's only like 11 or 12 weeks. It's great. But you do get tired of step. Like, there's only so much time you can spend with him before you think, right, that's me done now. That's not to say he's not the most beautiful thing I've ever seen.
Well, yeah. I think human beings, you know, they say human beings fall into two categories, cat people or dog people. I add a third category to that, cat people, dog people and baby people, right? Because there are clearly people out there who just love babies, do the whole coochie coo thing about anybody's baby.
That's me. But I do tire of staring at this. Like, well, you will never tire.
Well,
never.
I am. Yeah. Do you know what? Not only do I get bored staring at my own your babies, I am not interested in other people's babies. You know, and I really have to force myself to do it. It's a proper method acting gig to do the coochie coo thing.
Oh, I'm pretty good with that, really, because a lot of my friends had babies before I had a baby. So I was always pretty good at that, really, to be honest. But I do have two border collies and I do treat them like babies.
Yeah,
before I had George, when I was pregnant with him, I actually said to my husband, I went, I actually don't know if I'm going to love this baby more than them. I'm not really sure.
Do you ever tire of staring at the border collies?
No, No, you do. I have to say that because I've now said, haven't I?
So outed.
I'm going to drop myself in if I go, I don't get bored of staring at me dogs, but I do with me baby. No, I think it's with babies. I think it's just, it's that you're tired. You have to stop staring at them.
Gemma, number eight.
Just to go to sleep.
Number eight isn't necessarily, you know, something you observe. It's simply an instruction. Never forget the changing bag.
Never.
Literally, never.
Never. Yeah, yeah. I have an emergency bag for everything. Actually, just talking to your producer, Lizzie, on the way in, she said about the weather, and she said, oh, you know, I only put a light jacket on. I went, oh, I had my mum's spare coat in the car. So I was like, every mum has got a spare bag and a spare coat. I never used to be like that, but I'm so much more organised. I never go anywhere without the bag.
The flexibility of the bag as well, of course, it's for the change and the poo explosion, which is the worst case scenario. Yes. So the change of clothes are in there as well. But also, it's somewhere where you can put stuff. And if you've got other ones, you can put like drinks bottles in there as well. But also the flexibility of the wipe is that if you're on a day out, even if you're not with the baby, but you brought the change back because it's just so ingrained, you think, actually, I do have wipes. I went to a do in London and it was absolute. We were at this venue and it was on the banks of the Thames. It was absolutely scorching. And everyone was going, oh, I'm going to get up. So burnt today. And I went, I've got factor 50 in my bag.
Yes.
I went back to the changing room. I went, can I just get my bag? I just need to grab something. I had a bottle of factor 50. We're all dousing it. There were fellas there with bald heads. They were like, can I just borrow a little bit? I was like, yeah. Proper dad thing.
And
was.
Another mum tip where the wipes are concerned, I always have a little pack of antibacterial wipes.
That's in there.
So that, you know, if we go to any play areas or anything like that, my husband always laughs at me. He's like, stop chasing him around. I'm like, antibacterial wipe his hands before his dinner and whenever he comes out of any play areas.
Oh, I do that, but I do it when I've seen another child play on something. Let me antibacterial wipe that from that kid because I don't like the look of him. Number seven, quiet isn't always a good sign. Now, this is one of the things, Jim, that as a parent, sometimes you think, oh, that, what a racket. And suddenly it goes quiet. And then there's this gut thing that goes, oh, has something happened? Has something gone wrong?
Yeah, quiet isn't always a good thing. It's probably a good thing. But I also like the out of sight, out of mind. you know, I mean, we live in an open plan house. And, you know, we find that there is not a lot of private space in an open plan house. Yeah, I think maybe rooms were invented for a reason. and I think that, I'm sure the listeners have all got a great story about discovering what goes on when they discover why the silence has ensued. You know, there are probably, I can think of a couple of stories which are you couldn't talk about at 1 or 2 o'clock in the afternoon on local radio. But I think, yeah, you're probably right about that one.
Quiet isn't always a good sign. Number six, you can function on 4 hours sleep. You can, but very badly.
You can with coffee.
Yeah, you can function on four coffees an hour. You never did?
No, I never drank coffee. I might have had a cup of tea in the morning. Now, it's like, I need coffee. I never needed that before.
Sleep when the baby sleeps is the old adage.
Yeah.
Going to the loo in peace is over. We've got this now because my daughter used to just brush her teeth at the table with one of these kids' things. Now has to use proper toothbrush. So, like, now it's like, I need to brush my teeth, Dad. And it's like, right, okay. And then you have that conversation with you and you go, I'm literally trying to use the toilet. There's no peace in that one. Number four, you'll always be tired. Coffee. I mean, coffee. That's the answer to that one. Number four.
You do think, actually, there is a moment when you think you'll never be fully awake ever again. I think there is definitely an element of that. And I look back at pictures of me when the babies were babies. And, you know, I think to myself, there is an aging process that you frankly don't return from. You know what you're lucky if you're at all lucky, what you get is a kind of a wisdom that goes with it, but that's the only payoff.
Number three, we've already covered, baby wipes are not just for babies' bums. Number two, unconditional love, brackets until they're 15. No, unconditional love is still number two.
Sorry,
isn't there?
This is really true. On a serious note to that, that is so true. I think it's just there's something that just that just happens when you have a baby, and it's lovely. I thought I did have unconditional love with the border collies, and I think I do. But it's definitely, that's very true. That's
but it, so I think true. I think as well, the thing is how it grows that you think, well, I don't know. Yeah. You kind of think, I love this thing more than anything I can actually describe, but I feel like I love it more today than I loved it like a week ago. But that's not to say a week ago I loved it less than I loved it today. Yeah.
But I also think, you know, psychologically and from a complex point of view, there is something very different in terms of unconditional love. Father love is different to mother love.
Is it?
I think it is, yeah.
Let's find out, Gemma.
Yeah, do you know, I would say that it probably is, yeah. There's just something happened with the connection that a mother has. Like, I know instinctively if there is... Just by looking at George, I know if there's something wrong, if there's something right. If it's just, there's just an instinct that is there as a mother. I don't think it means that fathers love them any less.
I think it's different.
But I just think that it is something different.
It's the instinct.
Yeah.
Is it the instinct is different?
Maybe. Well, I think there's a nuance about it. I think. You say the intuition thing. I look at the way my wife is with our kids, and it's spooky in some ways. Mm-hmm. You know, the level with which she's got something going on. I mean, and I'm not saying that, as you say, I'm not to decry my bond with my kids. In many ways, actually, the strongest bond I have is with my eldest son, is my stepson.
Mm.
You know, it was our wedding anniversary yesterday, and we were talking about, we're reflecting on the 16 years we've been married and 20 years we've been together and all that stuff. And, you know, we've been very, very lucky, and we recognise that we've been blessed in that way. But if we've ever had a tough time, I always say quite openly that my stepson was the glue.
Yeah.
You know, in all of that. And my relationship with him is kind of really unique, because I think your parenting is tough.
Mm. It
is, you know, yeah. Step parenting is a different kind of tough.
Mm.
But in my experience, the bond that I have with my stepson is pretty unique and amazing.
Deep stuff on DADS. Yeah. Yeah. We got really Jim Johnson in the studio, we got Gemma Roberts as well. Coming up next, the number one thing that only a parent can know. And there's details of which I want a blow-by-blow account from each of you as to number one, and I'll tell you what number one is next on Radio City Talk. We've got Jim Johnson in the studio. We're talking about parenting matters and also making her debut. We've got a mum on the programme as well, comedian Gemma Roberts. We've been talking about the top 10 things only a parent can know. I think most people get a sense of some of these things. Number one is leaving the house, becoming a military operation. Now, we have sort of like an area between the front door and where the carpet starts in the porch, whereby everything happens. There's a pram in there. There's the bikes for outside of there. There's a little scooter in there. There's a shoe rack there. That becomes the absolute hub of activity. And only two people can ever be in there at one time. So we find that when we're leaving the house, it's basically we do it in stages, whereby dad and daughter leave before mum and pram then come behind, or it's mum and daughter set off walking and dad goes, I'll catch you up, because you can't have that many people putting shoes on at one time. You can't have that many people getting coats at that one time. You always do the check as well. Mobile phone, wallet, change bag, the correct number of children, keys, close the door. That's right, isn't it? That's as close to as right you can get.
Well, I think one of the things that you... this is like a top tip on parenting. When you buy a house, or when you're redesigning the layout of a house, my wife had the most brilliant idea, and she saw it, got it from a friend, of having a cupboard near the door, as big as is humanly possible, to just put everything in, right? Shoes, coats, everything. And the stuff that you'll accumulate if you move house, that you find in there, you know, like tennis rackets, you know, old magazines, relatives you haven't seen for years, you know.
Football boots, absolutely, not worn for 25 years.
All of that, right, goes there, the door shuts, and no one needs to know.
Oh, you see, I need to use this tip, because when you walk into our front door, there's just a billow of coats because we've got a coat hook on the left and we just never sort it out. So it's like sort of open the door, battle through the coats. before you do anything.
We had a thing at the start of summer thinking, well, we won't really need our coats, so we'll put some of these in wardrobes upstairs. We didn't do that. But no one's going to wear a coat for the next 3 months at least, because mm-hmm. Nobody's worn a coat for 3 months. I think we've got another 3 months of no coat weather. That's how optimistic I am. Still exactly the same.
Yes.
There's bobble hats there. There's the same pile of scarves that are there. There's all the boots for outdoor walking when it's minus 15.
The prams?
Still there. We got the pram, right? But we were going to a festival that was on a field. So we got the buggy out of the attic because it was a bit more lightweight and the pram's quite heavy. So then the buggy stayed downstairs in the porch. That stayed there until about 3 nights ago where I finally put it up and I didn't even clear the mud off it.
Oh, no.
And I thought, I'll put that in the attic now. It's still got mud on it, but I thought, you know what, I'll have to go get it down in a couple of weeks' time.
We had more prams than children. Literally, the amount of pramage that went through our house was extraordinary. Before we happened upon we're not going to say the brand name, but we know the one it is. It's the one that you can take apart and put together really, really quickly. It's like the Porsche of pram units. But in order, we had to trial and error with prams before we got to that point.
So you know the theory, the parenting theory on prams is that you get the 500 quid pram travel system, which has got everything. But after 3 months, you think it's either too big, it's too unwieldy, I don't know where all the bits have gone, and I don't know where all the bits go. You then get a really, really cheap one, which breaks, and you think, this is why you get the better ones. Then you find a really, really good one, and then 2 weeks later, your kids don't need it anymore. So you still, no matter what, you are getting three prams.
And there's always an element of that pram that you have never used.
Well,
the car, the actual carriage part, we never even used it.
Because they do that thing where they go, buy the bit that so they can lie flat and then get the seat. Does the seat go flat? Yes. Uh-huh. Well, why do you need the first bit? I don't know, but it's 180 quid, please.
Yeah, so we've got that piece of pram. We've never used it. Not once.
You got the parasol?
Oh, yes, yeah.
We had the parasol.
Just goes like this after about 5 minutes.
We had the parasol, definitely.
Yeah.
If they ever say, do you want the parasol as well? I'd always go, no. It falls over.
Yeah.
It's relevant when you're walking. If you're walking in a straight line under the sun, which isn't going to move, then you can place it and it's fine. But if you're walking around town, if you turn a corner, you need to move the parasol.
I mean, we are talking about the crown prince of pram units when we talk about this, aren't we? You know,
I don't know
which one you're. I'm not sure.
Yeah. Well, I don't know whether it's unfair to all the other units promote.
If you have found a good pram, I think you're allowed to mention that. In your opinion, this particular pram is good.
I have to say. And I'm at pains to admit it, because we had to go through so many prams. I mean, I get stick from my wife for having so many guitars. Well, a singer-songwriter needs guitars, right? You know, and different guitars for different kind of moods and things like that. I didn't realise we needed so many prams to get to this pram. But to be fair, the Bugaboo.
Oh, that's the three. Is that a three wheeler?
Yeah, it is. Yeah, it's big wheels and little cogs at the front. Man, that's some serious engineering.
And the parasol works.
The parasol, is a kind of an afterthought. But I'm telling you, it was streamlined. I actually drove over the Bugaboo. I ended up having two Bugaboos because I drove over one.
Yeah. With the child in.
No. I cannot remember under what context I drove over it.
The pram we've got at the moment, I think if I hit that pram in my car, my car would be worse off. It's like a tank.
It broke my wife's heart. That's all I'll say is that first Bugaboo.
If anyone's wondering, BUG-A-B00. Jim Johnston and Gemma Roberts with us. So the number one in the list of top 10 things only a parent can know leaving the house is a military operation. Again, if you've got dogs or cats, it might be a different story. Let's talk. Seeing as we've got a mum on the program, let's talk about the pain of childbirth. Harry Kane's partner has given birth. He said, our beautiful addition to the family, Vivian Jane Kane, so proud of his partner, Kate, for having the most amazing water birth, no pain relief at all, heart, hashtag my girls, hashtag hypnobirthing.
Amazing.
Were you offered hypnobirthing?
It's not something you're offered, it's a choice. So your midwife will say to you, you know, do you want to have a natural birth? And obviously they always promote having a natural birth. And it was something actually that I looked up myself and I thought, I'm going to do that. That looks like something I can do. It really wasn't. But the philosophy of it is great, I think, because it's, you know, it's a natural thing and it's all about breathing correctly and relaxing the room so that if you imagine if everything's tense and there's lots of medical equipment, it becomes more stressful. And so the idea behind it is that it's a really relaxed room and you bring your candles and your music and, you know. But sometimes birthing just doesn't go that way. I planned on doing that, but I needed to be induced. And every woman that was listening to this show now will go, oh, induced.
See,
oh,
but induced means, but then if you're induced, then things happen very quickly yeah. And your body sometimes suddenly goes, oh, what's going on
yes.
here? And yeah. I think the thing with hypnobirthing, really, it's preparing yourself mindfully as best as possible mm-hmm. for everything that's about to come, because of course for centuries though there was nothing else on offer. Broadcaster Julia Hartley Brewer, who's paid to have opinions, said, "I'm delighted."
She's an influencer
and his family. But why on earth should anyone be proud of not having pain relief while giving birth? Utterly absurd. There's a reason why women get pain relief during labour, because it hurts. What a stupid thing! What a stupid comment that is.
I think it's just a bit of a flippant comment because a lot of women would choose not to have pain relief. There's different things about pain relief as well, that, you know, at a certain point you can't have certain pain relief because it's going to have an effect on the unborn child if they're born within a certain space of time, and a lot of people don't want to have drugs put into the body when they're giving birth. I can understand all of those elements. So to just say you should have it is wrong. If you need it, then it's great.
The idea that you would say to somebody, why are you proud of your wife for giving birth? It's like, because it's one of the most spectacular things you've ever seen. And it makes you think that your wife is actually a superhuman.
The most middle class thing I've ever done was be a reluctant attendee at a series of National Childbirth Trust classes. Which my wife insisted on us going to. And I was a flippant and reluctant student at these. We were basically, there's five of us. It went round to the tutor's home, actually. And there were five completely different pregnant couples. And we went through a series of classes to prepare us for childbirth. And I mean, I've never been a terribly good student, so I was literally the naughty boy at the, throwing paper aeroplanes and things like that, and getting smacked by my wife. And I remember one of them was about induction, mm-hmm. Said one in five of you will be induced. And I'm there tutting, reeling off a load of other improbable statistics. And of course, smart Alec, weren't we the ones that were induced, right? Mm. Not just induced. That wasn't before, but she'd had some contractions and that hadn't worked. And we'd got a birthing ball, and the birthing ball was no use. So I'd decided at one point to, this is a famous story in our house, I decided at one point to see if the cat could do a trick on the birthing ball, which burst the birthing ball.
We were supposed to, before
we had to have the baby induced, we were going to have a home birth. And then none of it happened. So we ended up, we went in to have the induction. No, we booked the induction. I always remember the night of the induction, because it was the night that Shane Ward won X Factor.
Great.
X Factor 2. Right. So we're watching Shane Ward win X Factor in the room, and it's still the baby. And it was quite an unpleasant experience for my wife. You know, as it is, anybody would tell you, mm-hmm. if you've been induced, it's not nice. And then there was a complete difference of opinion between the midwife and the doctor.
Yeah.
The doctor basically said, we'll just continue with the induction. And the midwife went outside and I would see them basically having stern words. My wife's sitting on the bed and she's like quite uncomfortable, understandably. And anyway, I went out because I then suddenly remembered some of the NCT stuff, and they basically said, you are going to have to take control of this situation because there may be differences of opinion. I was like, oh my God, so far, you know, so much for my flippance. Mm. All the information that I've been so scornful about came into play.
There you go. Asked to make the decision, having previously been the man whose other decision was to put a cat on top of a birthing ball.
But just to say that actually, she not only had, she had to be, our daughter had to be an emergency C-section. And so to be fair, the NCT was a really worthwhile thing.
It is with induction. It is taken out of your hand. It is literally taken out of your hands. Like, I was in so much pain so quickly. And this is, again, like you were saying, after 48 hours of being on the labour ward and having pessaries and all kinds of things, that you then are, you're then induced. And it's really painful. I remember the anaesthetist coming in and she said, you can go to our second level of pain relief. I went, don't bother. Just bring him on in, love.
Stage five.
Anaesthetist called Dave came in, and I remember just grabbing his shirt and going, just get on with it, Dave, because he was going through the whys and wherefores and what can happen and, you know, and the dangers of paralysis. And I said, I totally understand all that. Thanks, Dave. Just carry on.
We're out of time.
It's very painful.
Guys, thank you for your time. Really appreciate you joining us on the programme. Gemma, when are you next on stage?
I'm doing a gig in Corwin tomorrow night in Wales. You can find actually all my gigs, if you don't mind me giving it a quick plug, on gemmaroberts.net, and you can follow me on Facebook on Gemma's Comedy Diaries.
Excellent. Jim, where can people find out about the work you do with Peshgar Productions?
At www.peshgar.co.uk.
Brilliant stuff they're up and about on Facebook as well. We're out of time. We're over time. Thank you for joining us for Dad's Hour this week on Radio City Talk.
Thank you so much.